Welcome, everybody, to the Get Bit Podcast, the podcast for blurs, for nerds. If you have a fandom, you are most certainly welcome here. We are your heroes. We are your heroes. I was also host of the evening because apparently I decided to go DC Super Friends. Of course, myself, Black Spartan, Tafari TV, and Show Guy Joe. How you guys doing?
Look, if you don't want to go see Joker 2 because you heard the reviews, Wild Robot and Transformers are still out.
Yep. Oh, and that's not what I want to do. There we go. Yeah, because, yeah, Joker Folie à Deux is not being warmly receptive. Surprise, surprise, surprise. Joe, how you doing, man?
Locomotive child, as of late.
Say what?
Said I've acquired a large locomotive child as of late.
Nah, congratulations.
Not really. He probably weighs the same as Zuri. I have nowhere else to put this thing but on the computer desk at this point.
That's still cool to get that as a gift, though.
You like Power Rangers? Do you want this? Yes.
Yeah, that is pretty cool. But as you can see, guys, we are a little bit older, so sometimes our words do fly. But hey, we're not that bad. At the same time, there may be some trailers and things that might be shown that might be too intense for younger viewers. So viewer discretion is advised. I'm stopping that welcome. So apologies, guys, for last week. Mother Nature decided that she's going to go undefeated. So we apologize that there was no show. But thank you, guys, for tuning back with us tonight. Let's start with where we were going to start with yesterday. Because I know Joe has seen the Thunderbolts trailer, he has looked at it, and I know he has thoughts about it. But before we get to those thoughts, if you haven't seen the teaser trailer for the Marvel Studios Thunderbolts, here it is.
I click leave on porch. Your subordinates will be reported to DoorDash HQ.
Alexei, it's me. Open up.
Milena?
Hold on!
Elena!
Hi, Dad.
Sorry about the wait. It was an important call.
Highly classified.
Lot of work, lot of work. Many irons in fire.
You feel fulfilled?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, so full. So filled. But why do you ask this? What brings you here?
There is something wrong with me. In emptiness, I'm just drifting. And I don't have purpose. I thought throwing myself into work was the answer.
No!
I'm Bob.
Who sent you, Bob?
Nobody.
Are you all? You were all sent.
Everyone here has done bad things. Shadow ops, robbing government labs, contract kills.
Yeah. So.
So someone wants us gone. What the hell?
We're brought up with this belief that there are good guys and there are bad guys.
What's the plan?
This could get messy.
But eventually, you come to realize that there are bad guys and there are worse guys and nothing else. Look at you. So adorable.
Ah!
She's bulletproof.
What happened to bulletproof?
It's bulletproof-ish.
Is that Bucky?
That's not good.
And that was the trailer from Marvel Studios Thunderbolts. As you can see, will be in theaters May 2025. So, fellas, I'm gonna start with my the resident. I guess we can call you the guy that knows more about Thunderbolts than probably most people in your local comic book store. So I'm gonna start with you, Joe. What do you think?
I do like when justice strikes like lightning. I'm okay with this. I do want to see more of it. I want to see the cast another actor, whoever is going to be either Sentry or who they got to voice the Void. Indeed, he is the main bad guy of this one. Everybody's been a Thunderbolt at some point in the comics. Even Taskmaster, he was a Thunderbolt under Kingpin, so everyone's been a Thunderbolt. I'm still curious how Zemo fits in all this, because it's not a Thunderbolt group without some tangible connection to Zemo. Yeah. So, but still, I dig it. I like that this is... it's been a week. Florence Pugh's, Yelena Belova's Thunderbolt team. Not Bucky's, even though Bucky is a leader of a group of Thunderbolts. So I'm looking forward to it. I think it's going to be a lot of fun. Like I said, I'm just really looking forward to see how well they do one of my favorite Marvel teams.
Gotcha. Safari?
So do we know if that's the same Taskmaster from Black Widow, or is that some? Because I know they got a different look, but we haven't seen who's under there. And I can't see why that person would continue doing this.
I would think it's a different Taskmaster, but Joe, you got any thoughts on that?
It's probably the same actress.
Yeah, so, okay, because I would think it would be the same, but I, like I said, don't know. But yeah, that was my question, is about who was playing Taskmaster, who was the person in the Master Taskmaster, considering the fact of Black Widow. I'm Joe, I'm with you on that. Zemo's bound to show his head up somewhere later in this movie. Because everybody's trying to figure out what the asterisk is by the Thunderbolts. But overall, I like the fact of just seeing Red Guardian again. Although I can't wait for the What If season of Bucky and the Red Guardian. That's gonna be something else. But
is Bucky a politician now?
Well, Bucky, I thought, was more of his revolution character. At least I thought it was. I could be wrong about that. I do know apparently Wakandian technology is now dishwasher safe. So yeah, there's that. So if you ever need to clean up your arm, I guess you can just throw it in the dishwasher and put it on steam. But that's a good question. Especially then, with the fact, I'm sorry, go ahead, Tamara.
I'll say, and then with is Val's team owning, or is the government buying Avengers Tower now, or
that is gonna be the $65 million question. Like, who is going to be in the tower? Because at first we thought it was going to be the Fantastic Four, but since that's a preset date back in the 60s, that's out the window. So
I'm another dimension.
And thank you. So yeah, it's going to be, it's a question. I to be honest with you, it's a toss up. But I will say this, whoever is in the tower, albeit, is going to basically shape what's happening next with MCU. But again, can't complain. Overall, the trailer looks great. Like Joe said, we need more. This is one time where more is actually needed in this case. But as we get closer to May 2025, I know more will actually show. But to move on to some news before we get to Sony State of Play, there was some news. And again, this is a slightly outdated, so bear with us. Kyle Chandler, you probably remember him from Early Edition, Friday Night Lights, a whole list of other shows this guy has been associated with. Now, keep in mind, this is kind of an older pictorial because at the time, he was in talks to star in the HBO series Lanterns, possibly as Hal Jordan. And apologies, guys, I didn't really do an update on this. I don't know if they're still in talks. for him to actually play the role of Lanterns on the HBO series. That could still be ongoing. I do know Mr. Cable himself did decline the role because at first he was in discussions with it, but he decided to decline it, but still said that Kyle Chandler would make a great addition to the role. So what are we thinking, guys? You know, in the world, I know for a lot of people, I know my favorite Lantern is still Jon Stewart, but for a Hal Jordan type, do we think the guy from Friday Night Lights could really pull this off?
I think it really depends on the direction of the show, because I didn't hate Ryan Reynolds initially. It was just when we did everything but what we thought we were going to do for that movie.
Mm-hmm.
Once we were making Hot Wheels racetracks, I realized we were just going in a completely different direction.
Pretty much. And you made the whole suit CGI animated, but I digress. Joe, what about you?
I'm really confused with the direction they're taking with these Lantern castings. We had a casting for Jon Stewart yet?
Nope.
There's we a have whole a Guy Gardner.
So this dude's 59.
Well, or... Guy Gardner is Nathan Fillion.
We know who Guy Gardner is. That's Nathan Fillion.
Yeah.
So, like, both the white dudes are pushing in their 50s and 60s.
Mm-hmm.
Because this guy is...
Well, I'm pretty sure he's got to be in his 50s. Kyle Chandler? He's got to be.
No, he's 59.
Yeah, I'm about to say he's got to be in his 50s. Because early editions, he was in his 20s.
I mean, I'm not going to do the usual Hal Jordy pettiness thing. Like, honestly and truthfully, this is a little weird that we're getting someone 60 years old to be Hal, and Nathan Fillion is Guy Gardner, which is fine. I love Nathan Fillion. I'm in season 2 of The Rookie. But I'm really confused why both of our casted Lanterns, or casting and casted Lantern, are in their 50s and 60s, unless we're for Gray Templed Hal, which means Parallax Hal.
If that's the case, you're gonna have an old as hell Alan Scott at this rate. If they're going that direction, they didn't say there was gonna
Alan
be
Alan Scott's not in this anymore. They did away with that.
Okay, so they did toss it. All right, because I was gonna say I thought he might be in this too. I'm not necessarily against it because I'm sorry. Go ahead, Joe.
So if Idris Elba does get casted, or we get a fairly tenured black dude, what is going on with the Lantern show? Like, are we really going to lean into the early 90s where we're also secretly casting a 20-something Kyle? Or, like, are we going to do something super weird where it's a mid-30s Jon Stewart?
I was gonna say if these are gonna be seasoned and established Lanterns, maybe
50-year-old and 50-year-old guy in Hal doesn't add up to me.
I would look at it like this, because right now, and I'm waiting for a trailer. I'm waiting for something, because it's really up in speculation right now. Because I can see them going older Green Lantern cores. I could see them going completely different. I'm gonna trust Gunn enough to where he's gonna be okay in the casting, to where it's gonna make sense. But I think I'm gonna reserve judgment until we see a teaser trailer or something like that. That would make me feel a whole lot better. But don't get me wrong. The casting so far, Nathan Fillion as Guy Gardner, that makes sense. If Kyle Chandler does get casted as Hal, I could see him doing Hal. And right now there's like four people talking in casting to be Jon Stewart right now, including the guy from Rebel Ridge on Netflix, which again is a good movie you haven't seen on Netflix, but there's like four people gunning for the spot of Jon Stewart. But I'm not against it.
If they decide really vary.
Say what?
Aren't their age ranges really varied? Because I know Idris Elba is rumored to be one of them, and he's up there too.
Mm-hmm. So I'm, that's the lesson playing.
We're doing something weird in secret, then.
I'm gonna wait. I'm seriously gonna wait for the trailer and just see what happens with that. But yeah, that's about the best way we can leave it till James Gunn hopefully delivers us another win. But before we get to our state of play news, guys, there is some news for Assassin's Creed. This itself for Assassin's Creed Shadows should not actually be surprising. because with every Assassin's Creed game, there is a delay. Ubisoft did announce that Assassin's Creed Shadows will now release on February 14th of next year. Really quickly, dear players, Assassin's Creed Shadows is a dream project for us, finally bringing the series to feudal Japan, with many features developed with our community in mind, such as parkour, the renewed stealth, brought by new technology, all set in a beautiful and immersive world. This is an ambitious addition to the franchise, a rich experience that can be lived through the eyes of two unique protagonists, but we realize we need more time to polish and refine the experience, pushing further some of our key features. As such, we made the decision to postpone the release date to February 14th, 2025. I'm okay with that. This is nothing new. Assassin's Creed games have always been delayed. Valhalla was delayed. Odyssey was delayed. Origins was delayed. Mirage was delayed, even though Mirage was kind of boring. But this is really nothing new. We have been saying here on Get Bit, when it comes to games, we'd rather they not be rushed. We'd rather they be polished. We'd rather they be as unproblematic as humanly possible, because we've seen what happens with games like Cyberpunk 2077, where when you push it out, it is a buggy mess. But after multiple patches and updates, it's actually a beautiful game to play right now. But it took almost a year of updates and patches to fix it. So with Assassin's Creed Shadows, because I'm definitely not playing as the ninja, because I am definitely playing as the samurai. And I can't wait long enough to play it. But again, a delay doesn't hurt. I mean, are we all thinking the same thing here, or should we be worried that they're pushing it back to next year?
I think it'll be fine.
This is going to die in February.
Is it going to die in February?
Oh, God, yeah.
Why?
It's coming out when Monster Hunter Wilds comes out.
I won't say it will not get attention. Will the active player number probably decrease? Yes. Will it stop sales? I don't think so. But I can see the point.
Do we see Monster Hunter eating a lot of potential sales for Assassin's Creed? Because it feels like two different niches over there.
Because that's the thing. You have a lot of Monster Hunter Monster Hunter players, myself included, because I'm slow on the track. But for the fact that this Assassin's Creed Shadows is really they learned their lessons from Mirage, and I think a lot of people want to play as protagonists. So I don't think Shadows is going to take, I'll put it this way, I don't think Shadows is going to take a massive hit. I think there might be a slight dip just because players will buy the game. Players will buy Assassin's Creed Shadows regardless. But to Joe's temperament, I will agree that if you do have some of those players who are Shadows players, are probably Monster Hunter Wild players and will probably jump on the server as soon as it's available. So I don't think it'll hurt sales the first week. I think it'll hurt playability. So I will agree to that. But I mean, either way, February is going to be a busy ass month. But as far as the delay goes, I mean, it's normal. I didn't see them sitting there saying, it's not like the day before. Like, they hyped up that game. It got near launch point. They scrapped the entire game and really screwed over a lot of gamers. I don't see Ubisoft doing that, at least with Assassin's Creed, not with this game. But again, I digress. But yeah, nothing to worry about. It's a delay like normal. But going into our state of play, before we get into some of these trailers, roundtable guys, you guys saw the state of play from a couple of weeks ago. What did you guys think? Was the state of play actually worth it, or was it just that we were just waiting on one game, or what do you guys think?
It was all right. I didn't really see anything that I was not too much that I was looking for. There was a couple okay announcements. I know the Bloodborne fans are raging right now
because there was no mention of a Bloodborne remaster.
I know next year apparently makes 10 years of the game, and people are hoping that will be when they pay it some attention. It's just weird that with people talking about that and the release of Astrobot, just, and then you claim you don't have enough original characters. I don't get Sony at all.
Well, I mean, that and again, the outside of a few titles that were mentioned, but I'm sorry, I'm getting ahead of myself. Joe, what was your thoughts on State of Play?
It was probably about a 7 out of 10. Pretty good start, slow middle. And then we all thought it was going to end on Horizon Zero Dawn re-release, which, you know, kind of mixed thoughts on that one. Because, you know, we at least get the benefit of a $10 upgrade from the game. But it ended on Ghost of Yotai, which makes it even better. I love the fact that we'll discuss that a little bit more when we get to the trailer. But yeah. I think it actually ended on a pretty good high note in the grand scheme of things.
Okay. Myself, I'm going to be honest, it was middle of the road. Just because there were some games that were announced, there were some surprises. And yet, the Horizon Zero Dawn, you know, the whole $10 upgrade, I kind of felt like it was nickel and diming, but let's be honest, it's Sony. Why are we surprised? But yeah, outside of that, it was a little underwhelming just because there wasn't a lot of new titles mentioned. But before we do get to the titles that we did want to cover, it is a safe bet. I'm sorry, go ahead, Joe.
So I do have one at least defense for Horizon Zero Dawn.
Okay.
We all know that game has been cursed multiple times when it comes out.
Yeah.
That's it. Every time it came out originally, Zelda would either be the week of or the week before and totally overshadow it.
Pretty much.
So this is like the only time we get a Horizon release, both of them, both LEGO and one remaster, which also gets the DLC for free in there.
Yeah.
Fully upgrade. So $10 upgrade. Huh?
It's the other one. The Frozen Wilds, not the Burning Sands. That's free, right?
Yeah, Frozen Wilds. Burning Sands is Horizon 2 DLC.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's Horizon 1 plus Frozen for basically $10 if you're already on the game, which was really good because that's on sale right now for like $15 a piece. So $20 in saving.
Yeah, it still feels like a nickel and dime thing. It's just for a PS5 upgrade. Oh, and also.
Go ahead.
No, go ahead. Go ahead.
I was going to say, let's be very honest. Despite the fact that the representation in Horizon Zero Dawn 2 was outstanding, I will always champion that. Gameplay-wise, it was not as good as Horizon 1 because I had to manage so much in Horizon 2 in terms of what gun had what equipment versus what weapon I had equipped on me at the time, plus the skill trees versus Horizon 1, where I think it was very straightforward of, okay, you have four weapons, just swap the ammo out at points.
Yeah.
Not stats on weapons.
It was over-customization. The over-customization of it all. Like, there's customization, and then I'll admit there was a little bit of overkill. There was a little bit of overkilling, too, so you are right about that. But before we get to these titles, really quickly, before we get to the trails, we do want to show you guys just really quickly the news that we did get from State of Play, that we are getting a Legacy of Kain Soul Reaver 1 and 2 remastered. Again, great games. Love to see them come back to the PS5. The Lunar Remaster Collection, again, a nice JRPG if you had a chance to play that. There is going to be updates to Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Shredder Revenge. DLC characters will be two new characters added to that. Also, Dragon Age The Veil Guard does have a release date, basically Halloween of this year is when it comes out. Alan Wake will get the Lake House expansion. That's going to be coming out this year. And Dynasty Warrior Origins, that game will be coming out January 17th of next year. So those are the games, and also Archeage Chronicles. Also, Hell Is Us. Also, great games. If you haven't checked them out, the trailers are available for you guys to see. But the trailers that we did want to talk about, this one was interesting because I didn't see this one. Joe brought this up, and I never thought I would be interested in a parkour raccoon. Tanuki Pond Summer is the name of the game. If you have not seen this, at first I was like, okay, Joe, what did you get us into? But as I looked at it, I'm like, this might be worth watching. But here it is, Tanuki Pond Summer.
It's a cozy game, but without farming.
A series or a franchise, or like what just happened?
Well, that game was called Tanuki Pond Summer. That was one of the games they showed at the Sony State of Play. And I missed the trailer at first. Joe had actually caught it, and I went back and watched it, and I was like, so basically, it's a parkour raccoon mailman. And as unique as that name is, I never thought I'd say this about some of those games. I kind of want to play this. but Joe, what was your thoughts on this game?
So it's one of those cozy games, except we don't have to farm. Like, we don't have to put plants in the ground. We don't have to do any of that. The whole premise is you're spending the summer to earn money to take care, maintain, and upgrade the Tanuki Shrine. For the summer festival and whatnot, you'll just be doing BMX deliveries, kind of like in the Yakuza minigame where you're doing food deliveries, crazy taxi style. Mm-hmm. But all across this little town in Japan, you're just doing hardcore parkour mail delivery and little side events. It's super cute. Like I said, cozy game.
I'm not gonna lie. I want to try it just because I don't know why a parkour bike riding mailman raccoon just screams fun to me. It really does. It really does scream fun to me. But Tabara, what do you think after that explanation?
It looks like Animal Crossing meets Sunset Overdrive. Just less intense.
Yeah, I can see that. But it does look great though.
This is how Tom Nook got his start.
That's when my mind went to when I saw payment.
Yeah. But it is...
The second big Tanuki game we've gotten. Because we did have Mame Bakaru game came out to... Mm-hmm. Actually did come out to America on the Switch.
Nice.
I'm also super annoyed that game got a quality of life update that Japan didn't get. So the English version is... actually better than the Japanese version.
For once, the West was preferred. Never thought I'd see that happen. But no, that's pretty cool. But before we get to the next trailer from Sony State of Play, really quickly, guys, if you have a PS5 and notice that you're starting to see ads pop up on your hub, get used to that. Sony has sat there and said that they're introducing on the next PS5 update a welcome hub, which is a revamp of the dashboard. Which means that you're going to start seeing ads like this, as far as games being introduced, as far as ads for games that were scored, is going to now become part of your welcome hub in the PS5. If you thought Ready Player One was a reality, was just telling a story, unfortunately it is reality that we just cannot escape ads. No matter where we go, no matter how much we pay for them, ads are like the inevitable Thanos that will invade our gamer screens. And now we'll start invading our display hubs. Now, of course, this is just Sony. Microsoft has not mentioned anything, but let's be honest, it's only a matter of time before we see it on our dashboards. Do we think, guys, that this is just the inevitable way of ads just being everywhere? Or is this another way for us to basically buy, basically entice the gamer to buy more games?
I'm checking mine now to make sure I haven't been infected yet. So far, I seem to be safe.
Yep, look for an update. It's a, the latest PS5 update is bound to, is actually bound to go out sooner or later. So you might want to
turn it here. It's just a tile. So if you look at the tile, you get the ad. If you don't look at the tile, it's not a big deal.
But it's still there.
Which tile? Is where,
basically like right here. Like in this screenshot right there, for example, how Warhammer Space Marine, like they literally have the ad right behind it. So that's the crazy part about all this is this that, and again, like I said before, ad space is just inevitable. Like right now, Hulu, Max, all those other streaming stations, all those other streaming channels, all of them are now having, remember we used to pay for ad free content, and now that's starting to go by the wayside, or you gotta pay more to not have ads. So it's one of those things to where I think it's just going to be inevitable that we're just going to wind up just seeing ads everywhere, including our games. But because it's Sony, Sony's going to be like, you know, what you going to do? Go to Microsoft? Go to Microsoft or go to Steam? Which are you going to do? Either way, you're going to find us. But that's just my opinion on it. I think ads are just, you know, like Joe said, if you don't look at it, you know, don't worry about it. But for me, it's like, I would like my gaming dashboard to be ad-free. I'm just saying. But anyway, outside of that, let's see. We do got to talk about this before we get to the Star Bites because we were expecting a Ghost of Tsushima. We were expecting a sequel. We did get a sequel, except as Joe had pointed out earlier, it's not Ghost of Tsushima. It's actually Ghost of Yotai. And I'll be honest, it looks freaking beautiful.
We are beyond the edge of Japan. People come north to disappear. But you are hunting. And now, every Ronin here is after you. Still think you're the hunter? Thank you.
Now, that was the trailer, guys, for Ghosts of Yotai. As you can see, it comes out in 2025. I really wish the Sony's the state of play for Sony led with this. They really, really, really should have led with this because it is freaking beautiful. But guys, what do you think?
Maybe I'll finally pick up Ghosts once I am free from Final Fantasy because I've heard it's actually pretty fun and not that hard to platinum. I have the trial. I do not have the free game. Damn it. I still need to play the original Ghost of Tsushima, but everyone is really excited for this and has been singing its praises. So, yes, the weirdos have been online making all their angry thumbnails, but whatever.
Oh, yeah. Because the protagonist is a woman. But, Joe, what are your thoughts?
This is a very exciting time in Japan. 1603, this is where the Shogunate. This is also the start of the Edo period, where all of our anime comes from historically. It is in the Edo period. This is an unrivaled time of peace in Japan. Yotei is actually modern day Hokkaido, which is at this point in time, not formally part of Japan.
Mm-hmm.
So I wonder if it has to do with the Shogunate trying to formalize Yotei to become part of Japan. I don't know what the big thing is. Lots of stuff happens.
He might have froze.
Let me look here. 1603, defeated by the Sun. 1607, Korea joins. Korea Joseon Dynasty sends an embassy. Ryukyu Isles become a vassal of the Satsuma Domain. 1614. Tokugawa Ieyasu bans Christianity from Japan. This also starts a big period of isolationism to all foreigners at this point in Japan. So there's a large amount of stuff that just happens that can be turned into a story. Now, a lot of people are also very unhappy that this is not continuing because the story from the first one, because the Mongols do make a second attempt at conquering Japan. But they get wiped out by a hurricane again, or a tsunami again, because that is what happened to the Mongols' first invasion. Is they decide to invade during tsunami season and gets just wrecked. So they try again later, once again in tsunami season, and once again just get wrecked. It's where the term kamikaze actually comes from, which is God's wind.
So Mother Nature's undefeated.
Just oh God, yeah. If it's not Mother Nature, we got the lizard. We got the lizard.
No, that's pretty cool. No, go ahead, Joe.
So yeah, I'm really looking forward to it. Erika Ishii, she seems to be a whole lot of fun. If you look her up or stuff, she kind of seems like just another chaos goblin ready to be unleashed upon the populist, because she looks, just seems like a lot of really fun person if you go to her Instagram. Regardless of what all the boo-hoo, it just outs me as people who are just afraid of women. I don't understand it.
It's basement incels. It's like, why do we always gotta have women? I don't know, maybe the fact that we just need to have a change in scenery for once in a while.
Didn't y'all binge Blue Eyes Samurai this year and it won an award? Like, what's the
right? You binge the crap out of Blue Eyes Samurai and not one individual complained, not a one. But again, I digress. But definitely looking for Ghost of Yotai when that comes out. Some other trailers we're going to get to before we get to our Keanu news, because we do have a couple of Keanu news and a trailer. This last trailer we have from the Sony State of Play called The Star Bites. This is an interesting RPG, and it's kind of a quick one. This is actually the teaser trailer for it.
다 죽어가는 행성이라 멀쩡한 게 하나 없다니까.
괜찮아, 괜찮아. 여행을 떠나는 건 언제나 즐거우니까.
So, like I said, short but sweet. That's basically called The Star Bites. It reminds me of a little bit of Wild Arms, if Wild Arms and Mecha and MechWarrior were put together. But I kind of dig it. Looks like it'll be coming out on Xbox and PC. Not a date on release date on that yet, but what do you guys think?
Slight custom robo vibes from it a little bit with the like little hub world aspect. I'm curious to see what the turn-based combat is like, but is it? It seems like they're like either mining or on some kind of mission on that whatever planet. I'm curious if it's also going to be one world or many.
I can kind of see that. Joe, what do you think?
I'm so mad it's not coming out on like the Switch or PlayStation.
It doesn't look
more than likely. I bet it will come out on the Switch at some
point. Yeah. It'll probably be the Switch 2 coming out. If they ever do announce it. But no, it does look good. What are you going to say, Joe?
No, like I said, it looks like a lot of fun. I dig that Korea is putting out quality work like this. Like I said, I'm just mad I'm not going to be able to play unless I get like a decent gaming PC, which is never going to happen because I don't have the money, or an Xbox, but I just can't bring myself to do it. That red ring hurt me to my soul, and I'll never go back.
I mean, at this point, though, the way these scalpers are taking down PS5s, you're better off building a budget build PC at this rate, because ain't nobody about to pay. Well, I take that back. Somebody's paying $6,000 or $7,000 for a PS5 Pro 30th anniversary one, but not I. But yeah, all looks good. So Keanu news, which I never thought I'd say that in the same sentence. We're going to first start with Sonic Shadow Generations because there is an update to that. And if you recognize the voice, well, let's just say the man gets around.
I've taken on another form?
And yes, you heard right. Keanu Reeves is joining Sonic X Shadow Generations as part of the upcoming Sonic the Hedgehog 3 movie pack. This update is inspired by scenes from the Sonic the Hedgehog 3 movie and arrives December 12th. The Sonic the Hedgehog 3 movie pack is included in the Digital Deluxe Edition, which lets you play the game 3 days ahead of its October 25th release date.
So by show of hands, who's getting the movie pack?
I pre-ordered the physical edition, so I don't get it. So it's only if you get like the enhanced digital version of the game. So I think I get Gerald's Journal and classic Sonic Adventure Sonics as a skin, and that's about it. I think I have to wait till November for this.
Yeah, I mean, it does look good, I will say that, but I would almost, it almost makes me want to get it. I know, Zuri. I know. I can't be spending money. I got to be spending money on you. Joe, what did you think about the update that's included in the movie pack?
I mean, if I end up getting it, I'll definitely be picking it up. It seems fun and just leads me to believe that after Johnny Silverhand throws himself down the digital well, he becomes Shadow Hedgehog. Just link Cyberpunk 2077 to Sonic the Hedgehog.
That would be interesting, I will say that. But that's not the only Keanu news. But before we get to that, Sonic is Batman. And I know it's going to feel weird saying that, but this trailer will actually explain the partnership between the DC and Sonic.
Hey, everybody. I'm so excited to be here at Sonic Central. I'm Tiffany Smith, and I'm joined by Evo. How you doing?
I'm good. Thank you.
Okay, so you know why you're here, right?
I do.
We are here to get to the bottom of what Sonic posted on Batman Day.
We are.
If you guys don't know what I'm talking about, take a look. It's so good.
It's fun, right?
For a lot of you guys watching, you know I'm a huge DC fan, but Sonic the Hedgehog was the first game that I ever played all
really?
The way through.
Yeah, you did?
Yeah. So I'm very excited to be here and hear more about this mashup. What does this collision actually entail? Can you give us some details?
Well, it's going to start with comics, and that's going to start in March of 2025, and we're going to have one issue a month.
So you're talking about comics. We're talking about the content. Does this mean we're really going to get to see Sonic the Hedgehog and some of his friends maybe teaming up with the Justice League characters?
I think so, and if you want to talk about it, we can.
Yes. Okay, who's overseeing all of this?
So we have a writer who's super well-known, and everybody loves him, and that is Ian Flynn.
So good! Okay, so I know you're not going to tell me the artists, but we've already seen one mashup. We've got Shadow as Batman. Can you show us some of the other ones?
Sure, let's do it.
All right, who's Superman?
Knuckles.
Wonder Woman.
Amy.
So good. Flash.
Sonic, of course.
Green Lantern.
Silver the Hedgehog.
Ooh, and Cyborg.
Tails.
All right, I'm just going to call it right now. I'm going to go OG. My favorite is Sonic as the Flash.
I'm going to go Shadow as Batman.
Mm-hmm. We know where your allegiances lie.
That's right.
Those are so epic. I'm so excited for this. Is there anything else that you want to share with everybody watching?
Yeah, sure. So besides the five comics that we talked about for March 2025, we're also going to do a collected edition of all those comics, as well as merchandise, including apparel, accessories, toys, collectibles, and all of this will be for fall 2025.
I know what I'm going to be reading, buying, wearing in 2025.
And me too.
You've shared a bunch of stuff with us, but I think there is possibly one more secret that you want to share with everybody.
Yeah, let's do it. Let's do it here on Sonic Central exclusively. You ready?
I'm ready.
All right. We're going to continue the celebration of DC and the Sonic universe through 2026.
Shut up. So the party is literally just getting started. We thought it was just till 2025, but now 2 years, baby.
Just getting started.
I'm so excited. Thank you so much, Evo, for joining us. And you guys, make sure you let us know your favorite mashups and enjoy the rest of Sonic Central.
So, guys, what do we think? Shadow is Batman. Sonic is Flash. Amy as Wonder Woman. Tails as Cyborg. I mean, I'm not against it, but I do dig the direction they're going in. But what do you guys think?
It fits. I'm curious to see what their plans are since this is the year of Shadow and it takes place next year. I'm curious what all they're planning to do for a rollout next year as far as that, or how long, if the comic's going to be a one-shot or if it's going to be like a series of things we can pick up.
I would say since they're doing it till 2026, I don't think it's going to be a one-shot. I think it might be a limited run.
Okay.
My money's on limited run because, you know, if they're doing a two-year partnership, I see a couple of comic book runs. I see a potential DLC in some aspects. But overall, yeah, I'm just curious to see what else they would do within this 2 years, be kind of honest. But Joe, what about you? What do you think?
I noticed they didn't Aquaman.
Yeah, they didn't. They did not mention Aquaman. You're kind of right about that. But who would be what? Big the Cat? Maybe Big Vector.
Oh, Big the Cat could be.
No, one. Vector would be Martian Manhunter.
You don't think that belongs more to Espio? I feel like he's more of the.
Espio would be the question.
That fits, actually. Yeah, all the teams. Yeah, Chaotix can be the out there characters.
Yeah, the Chaotix could be the outsiders.
That is true.
Shadow and the outsiders.
Who would Charmy be?
Robin.
Yeah, gee, that works.
I can see that.
So, but I mean, no. The other thing that they're probably doing, and if it's out way out in 2026, more than likely there's going to be an animated movie.
Yeah.
I can see it, because right now they just dropped the newest episode of the Dark Beginnings, like, anime short. So I can see they seem to be playing a lot with, like, short-form animation. So I can see them doing that throughout the next couple years just to kind of bridge the gap between whatever the next big movie or spinoff show is.
Yeah, I can see that.
Probably Silver's been Green Lantern for a while and just never told anybody. And none of the Green Lantern Corps are going to blink an eye at this?
Probably not.
Yeah, it does look interesting. But with that two-year partnership, we're going to see what else comes down the line. But the last trailer we do have, really kind of the last bit of news we have before we get to our comic book pulls, is the last trailer we have for Ballerina. From the world of John Wick. This was kind of teased during chapter 4, but here's the actual trailer for it.
Do you like to dance? I know a school where they teach dances. I could take you there if you'd like.
The assassin. You must become the assassin. You will always be weaker. You will always be smaller. You want to win? Improvise. Adapt. Cheat.
Welcome to the Continental.
Eve Macaro of the Ruscaroma. What a pleasure to see you again.
Ballerina, you must see me.
You have no idea what you just walked into.
They killed my father. This isn't done until they're dead.
Fate is a very humbling thing.
You're him. The one they call the Baba Yaga. How do I start doing what you do?
Looks like you already have.
And that was the trailer, guys, for Ballerina. I'm hooked. There is no other way I can say that. I am freaking hooked about this. For it to be in the same world as John Wick. But what do you guys think?
Same thing I said before, I wouldn't be surprised if Wick has a Halle Berry-sized cameo from the third movie. Which apparently everyone's saying that they think it's either... I think this takes place alongside the third movie. Like they are crossing paths in the midst of... both of their own missions or whatever. Also, do we know when, if this is Lance Reddick's last role or if he has other stuff?
Yeah, that was his last. That was his last role.
Damn, man.
Yeah, that was definitely his. That was his last role. So yeah, that's gonna make it bittersweet. But Joe, what do you think?
I mean, it looks fine to me. I'm not really that intrigued to watch it. I like. I mean, I'll give it a shot, but it's just like not real high on my list with other stuff coming out. We got Agatha currently going on, which is being really good. Congrats to all the Marvel conspirators. They finally said the word Mephisto. Everyone give yourself
a golf clap. Yeah, we're going to get to that momentarily. Because I completely forgot about
Agatha. We got the new Yakuza series. We got the new Yakuza series coming out, which is based on Yakuza.
Okay. Well, as far as
Majima and Kiryu doing Majima and Kiryu things. Like I said, the Bowery just doesn't hold my interest. I love John Wick, but just like I like where it was, and I like it was a self-contained story. I don't feel the need to expand on it any more than they already have.
See, that's where I'm on the other side, because I did like the Continental that was on Peacock. That was a limited series. I kind of want to see what happens with the Russian Dollhouse, if they're telling a different story, because honestly, it would have to run parallel to John Wick for her to run into John Wick before Chapter 4. And also, seeing Lance Reddick, you know, still seeing him in one of his final performances is definitely going to be bittersweet. But I mean, I'm looking forward to it. I actually want to see what Ana de Armas does as her character and how she does tie into this world of Hitman, really. But yeah, it looks like it's not going to disappoint. And thank God they kept the same fight choreography team, because that would have been weird. But thank you for reminding me, Joe, because before we get to comics, Agatha All Along, we've all seen the latest episode, right?
Yeah.
Can we just conclude that either that's either speed or that's an unknown Marvel character yet to be named as far as who Teen is?
I see everybody's still going. Everybody's been going for Wiccan.
Mm-hmm. I mean, because it's like the way it's told and the way it's adding up to be, it's like, correct me if I'm wrong, this is just one backdoor way to bring back the Scarlet Witch. Because we all know she's not dead. We all know a couple of boulder bricks is really not going to stop her. She basically is the Darkhold itself. So the fact that, you know, quote unquote, she's dead, you didn't see a body, it didn't happen. So that's what makes me think the boy and all this is going to be tied into it. But people are kind of complaining about the musicals. The musicals are what makes the show fun to me. I mean, Down the Witch's Road is already a top Billboard hit. Disney knows what it's doing sometimes when it does music. And the fact that, you know, Down the Witch's Road is still a high playing number. The fact that we had another number in this week's episode. And the fact that, you know, as Joe had pointed out last week, you Mephisto fans were happy to hear the name get mentioned, although you didn't really see a body, you didn't really see horns. But, I mean, overall, I mean, what do we guys think of Agatha so far, considering we're now three episodes into a, what, eight-episode series?
I think 4 out of 9, I want to say. Because we're supposed to be done by Halloween, apparently.
Yeah.
I don't know. Teen is giving me young Barry from the Flash vibe. So it's, I need him to be useful by the end of this, other than whatever his shallow reasons of wanting to like fly a broomstick are. Mm-hmm. I'm loving Patti LuPone's character more than I expected. She's hilarious. And then I'm curious to what's going on with her. Or what is she seeing? Like, I know her character is a medium, so I feel like she is because I know, I forget what type of witch she is, but I feel like a medium is not in her expertise. It's just something she did to make money. And I feel like she's opening a doorway to the other side and doesn't know how to close it, which is why when she spaces out, I feel like it's always somebody from the other realm talking to specifically one of our other characters.
And just comes in and takes over.
It's clearly Homegirl's mom was there this episode, but
yeah.
I'm also curious who was telling them to save Agatha when nobody likes you.
That is kind of saying a lot, ain't it? Also, the Curse Girl. The Curse Girl is supposed to be the protector witch that only she can see said demon that apparently currently curses the women in her family that she roasted alive. It's just interesting now that, okay, so I think we can take apart from Agatha that the Witch's Road, almost everybody's going to be facing a fear. Like, old girl faced the fear of her mother. The fact of two of the previous witches saw people haunted from their past while in the house. So I'm not complaining about this. I actually like where this is going. Do I think all of them are going to make it? It's starting to become like a Walking Dead thing. Like, who is going to survive the next episode? So far, we only had one death so far. Rest in peace, Mrs. Foreman. You shall be missed. But no, I mean, overall, I really do like Agatha because it's different. And right now, Marvel needs different, but also at the same time needs consistency. Hey, Geek by Heart. But what do you guys think as far as that? I mean, because a lot of people are kind of hating on this. And like, let's be honest, whenever it comes to Marvel, there's going to be some people that are just not going to like what Marvel puts out. They live to complain. And I usually take those people with a grain of salt. But, I mean, is Agatha living up to the hype? Or, you know, should we be concerned? I don't think we are. But what's your guys' thoughts?
What do you got, Joe? I feel like you know more about this than I do.
Shoot, I'm learning on episode-by-episode basis.
One moment.
Okay.
I mean, my only real question is, how many more variations of Down the Witch's Road are we going to get? Because I will be completely honest with you. The moment we get the country western version, I'm tapping out.
Oh, it's coming.
It doesn't need to. Let me know when we get to the Daft Punk variant.
You know it's coming. Hey, Lady Mandalor. I just saw your stream. I was like, she's playing, and I can't comment. But what are you gonna say, Joe?
So, like, I want to say this ends in Wanda. This teen could also be a misdirect, and it really could be Agatha's child she gave for the Darkhold. Just reincarnated and sharing a similar story to Wiccan and Speed, where they are souls reincarnated into another person's body, which is how Wiccan and Speed are alive currently. Mm-hmm. Wouldn't put it past Marvel to do that in this one. I want them to kind of amp up more of the spooky horror elements. That demon kind of came straight out of Buffy, I'm not going to lie.
A little bit, yeah.
A little bit.
Now, with the way the new Green Witch popped into the thing, I want more of that. I want more of the Army of Darkness that they can conjure up.
So more Sam Raimi?
More Sam Raimi Army of Darkness style and goofy horror, as long as it's more horror elemented. Whether or not end in Wanda, I don't know, but you just never know at this point. Because Elizabeth Banks?
Yeah.
No.
No, the person with Olsen. Oh, the person with Green Witch. Olsen. Oh, yeah, there you go.
Olsen.
Yeah.
No, yeah, the Elizabeth Green Olsen Witch. Is Wanda.
Yeah.
I don't remember what the Green Witch. Aubrey Plaza. That's it. Yeah. Aubrey Plaza is the new Green Witch. But no, I mean, Elizabeth Olsen was very forthcoming. It's like, no, I'll come back for Wanda. You just gotta like give me a good reason to come back to Wanda.
Yeah, her story
is right. To me, mm-hmm. whenever they say that, it's like when you can pull up two dump trucks of money to my front lawn, then we'll talk.
Or you getting that Robert Downey Jr. money, getting the points on the end of the film profits, what I'm looking for. But no, But yeah, overall, Agatha looks like it's going to be great. Penguin, really quickly, episode two. I was like, wow, it's only been two episodes. Not complaining about that. Yes, it is Sopranos, but it's Sopranos and Gotham, which means you have multiple crime families. The fact that that Oz is playing both sides between the Falcones, the Maltories, the fact that poor old his co-pilot couldn't do it, and he had to give him a life lesson, which I feel like Oz kind of gave him the school hard knocks in a way, where at the end he's like, you know, you almost got me killed. I had to turn around and think on my feet. Kind of giving him like, look, if you want to be a part of this life, you got to learn to think on your feet. Otherwise, you're going to wind up dead, and I'm going to be the one burying you. But overall, it was a solid episode following the first one. It's just, and the fact that it's going to be a limited series, this is the one thing I hope they don't do. I don't need them to wrap up an entire Penguin story in a limited series. If it ends open-ended, I'm okay with that. But I don't want them to change the pace. I don't want them to, you know, shortchange it or just try to twist it. Basically, what I'm saying is don't do Gotham. Don't do Gotham in the final season where you feel like you got to tie up loose ends. Right now, it's fresh. It's perfect. I'm really rooting for Oz at this point, which I never thought I'd be rooting for really the main character who is a villain in a series. I never thought I'd be rooting for as an underdog. But Tafari, I know you watch it. What do you think?
It's weird because he's such a weasel. So it's weird to see how he's going to pull it off and get away with it every episode. Because it's like he's at the bottom, whereas Sopranos was just Tony trying to keep everyone in line every other episode and having to take accountability or care of people's stupid shit. Whereas this show, this dude just keeps finding ways to worm his way out of situations. When it's like, even the room clearly knows he's like a snake.
Oh yeah, absolutely. But it's just crazy where it's like they still underestimate him. It's like, we know there's an angle here. We know you're not just going to settle for this. And they keep underestimating him. It's almost like every situation, either he talks himself out of or he throws somebody else into it, and it's smooth how he does it. But, no, go ahead. What are you going to say?
The guy who plays Whistler from Blade, that's not the same dude in the prison, is it?
No.
Okay. I saw the headline as I was watching, so I'm like, is this the same person?
No, not Chris Christopherson, although rest in peace, Whistler.
Yeah.
But no, it's not him. But yeah, it is so crazy where it's like this man is really going to have two crime families go at each other's throats and Slick moving at the same time. Although I'm kind of hoping that old boy, I'm kind of hoping that Mr. Victor, he makes it. I hope he makes it. I feel like he's going to slip up and get himself killed. I hope, you know, like I said before, he's not going to, I'm not going to lie. At first, I thought he was going to be, Victor's eyes. I thought he was going to wind up being him until, spoiler alert, if you hadn't heard the second episode, you hear that, a murderer has murdered seven women that escaped from Arkham. If you heard that on the radio, you already know that in this world, Victor's eyes does exist. It's just that, again, a lot of the Gotham villains are in the background. So they're really just focusing on the crime families right now.
I heard that and the Hangman.
Yep. Hangman is out. Calendar Man is out. It's interesting how many villains slowly but subtly got mentioned, and yet in this series, you see none of them. And it's perfect. I did not need to see any of Batman's rogues galleries villains. I didn't need to see Batman. The fact that you're staying this low level with just this side of Gotham story you're telling is freaking perfect, in my opinion. You don't really need to overdo it. But again, second episode. This is also limited series. I can't wait to see what they do from that. But before we do get to our comic book, guys, I did always want to shout out people because they shout us out whenever we drop on their streams. Geek by Heart. If you do go to Geek by Heart on YouTube, the person there, Lainey, she's actually doing a playthrough of Legend of Zelda: Echoes of Wisdom. Definitely check her out. She is also fun to talk to. She also plays Hogwarts, even though she still plays a Slytherin. But, you know, I'm more of a Gryffindor type. I'm not going to hold that against her. But definitely check her out. Also, Room Full of Blurs. Definitely check out Lady Mandalore because I slipped up and saw her playing welcome. I'm so proud of you. But definitely check out, again, Room Full of Blurs, also on YouTube. Check out also Room Full of Blurs on all the socials, or Lady Mandalore, because she is doing a lot, not just video game playing, but hosting, talking, all that stuff, even voicing. So definitely check them out. Again, I want to show them love because they show us love. And again, thank you guys, because they are all a part of our podcast brethren. That also being said, before we do get to our comic book pulls of the week, we always do want to show love to Rick's Comic City, Nashville's number one place to go to for comic books, for mangas, for collector's items. You want it, they have it there. Two locations, Nashville and Clarksville, Tennessee. Also, their website at rickscomiccity.com. You can do the same things there. Let them know the guys at Get Bit sent you. Doesn't get you any discounts, but lets you know that you see our mugs on their television, so they show us love, so we show them love. Definitely check them out if you are in the middle of Tennessee area. If you are not in the middle of Tennessee area, guys, please, 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 please support your local comic store, support your local libraries. I know Barnes and Noble's. I've heard that from Blurred's Eye View. I have to sit there and say it now. Barnes and Noble's, I get it. It's great. Starbucks, it's great. Any place with a coffee book store is great, but you can't beat the experience of going to a comic book store. Not just the fact that you can get your favorite comics, your favorite pull list, your favorite mangas, your favorite toys, posters, collector's items, you name it. It's the fact that you can actually have an experience there. And these places need your patronage to survive, because trust me, they're fading deserts at most. Also, libraries. Guys, kiddos, if you're listening to the sound of my voice, please read the banned books. There is a banned book section in almost every public library now. There are, again, you know, not to get too political, but there are some school systems that have books out there that they don't want you to read, but you highly should read. They expand your mind. They expand your vocabulary. They expand your way of thinking. So, guys, please read the banned books. You will be better for it. Now, with that being said, Joe, are you ready, sir, with the comic book pulls?
Yep, I'm trying.
You're good. You're good. As Kira and Lanny are just having a full-blown conversation. But I always laugh whenever I see them talking. But, you know, I'm going to point them out every chance I get. But outside of that, let's see. What else? I'm about to say we don't have anything else coming up. Any other major... Yeah, we do. There is another thing coming up besides the Video Game Awards. We're not too far off from that. But
was it again, Tokyo Game Show or something else?
Yeah, Tokyo Game Show wrapped up. That was last week, which not a lot actually got said there. So it was like the most we got was the Capcom Fighting Games, which, again, the collection is out and can't wait for that. But yeah, that's the big thing. It's just that, oh, and the rage quitting from from Marvel versus Capcom, just because a certain person is playing a menace out there right now, just making people rage refund, which I didn't think was a thing. But yo, I see that you're up.
Is it Wazzled?
Yeah, don't get Wazzled. Look, if I get Wazzled, I'm going out like the guy who boxed Jason on that rooftop.
I mean, you might as well go out on your sword. I mean, come in, come back with your shield or on it. But I'm sorry, Joe. I see that you're up, so go ahead when you're ready.
I had to play such a scrubby Marvel versus Capcom team. I had to play such a scrubby MVC dude team of Juggernaut, Hulk, and Colossus. And just win through attrition with power, with armor, and just spamming Colossus shoulder charge.
Mm-hmm.
I hated myself for that. And then which I got works better because I went and played Terry in Street Fighter.
I was going to say, a win is a win.
Yeah.
No matter if it's by an inch or a mile, winning is money. There's no such thing as a fair fight. There's no such thing as a fair fight,
Joe. All right. Comics. So, comics. We're looking at Green Arrow number 16, this is an absolute power tie-in. This is also the final issue, save for an annual that Josh Williamson's going to be doing.
Mm-hmm.
He's moving on from this book to another book. This is just the finale of Green Arrow season one. Ollie gets his family back and then immediately goes back to working for Waller, turns everybody in, but they're already in the middle of a prison breakout. Defeats Bright, who we get to learn the actual identity of Bright, mm-hmm, in this issue. That's pretty much it for this. It's fine if you're a Green Arrow fan. Nice twist on who Bright was. I'll give him that.
Yeah, it did make me mad until I read the last Absolute Power issue, and I was like, okay. It was a long burn, but I understand about this issue, though.
Yeah. And it is written by Josh Williamson with art by Amanki Nihulapan and Sean Izakase. We'll go with that because I can't pronounce that. Colors by Ronaldo Fernando Jr., Romello Feraldo Jr. Going on to this one, Task Force 7, number 7, going to fight the Global Guardians. Guys, I'm going to be honest with you. This is like a really weird way to cap off Task Force 7. We're going after like Buona Beast and the Scarlet something or other, like Justice League Europe, basically.
It's
the final one, and it just like, okay. This is written by Dan Waters and art by Fran Galen. This was a book. This is a book that tied into a lot of other books.
I'm not going to lie with this book. It for this to be such a great run in Absolute Power, this was probably the most unnecessary book out there.
Yeah, like, I think it's because they're heroes that not a lot of us are aware of.
Mm-hmm.
Like, even I'm like, I kind of know who that is, but like, only from the 80s era of Justice League.
Yeah, but the fact that they were, it was the fact that they were throwing them in and it felt forced. And I'm like, why are we even discussing this? Yes, the Mazer robots were sent to seek out and capture other supers and their powers, but it's like this feels like the filler. This feels like the filler issue within the run. We didn't really need it.
Which is a shame because this is issue 7 of 7. Like,
they wait till the end to give us filler. Sounds like Naruto.
And then that filler lasts for about 5 years.
True.
But yeah, so moving on over, we have Absolute Power number 4. This is the finale. Everything ends here. Spies revealed. Amanda Waller gets taken down. Amazer robots go away. Everyone gets their powers back. Wally gets back to his normal Flash costume. I'm just telling you, good book, solid read, how it ended. It's a shame that something happened and DC Universe Prime is now in a bizarre state of play.
Although I do want to point out one thing. Batman was being hypocritical of Martian Manhunter. I'm going to leave it at that. I'm not going to spoil it, but it's just like, that's like Tupac meat kettle.
How is that any other normal day for Bruce?
No, I mean the fact that, you know, Martian Manhunter pulled a Batman, and Batman was like, really? You kind of took my shtick. Although that was the greatest contingency plan ever put together that no one ever mentioned.
This is true.
But still, good issue.
So literally, and this is written by Mark Waid with art by Dan Mora. This is the finale, so go read it. Now, immediately kicking off the next chapter in the DC, we have the All-In Special, which is going to be the new thing going, the new storyline, overarching storyline going forward. Mm-hmm. This is written by Josh Williamson, Scott Snyder, with art by Wonder Woman's artist Daniel Semper. Central art spread by Dan Mora, colors by Alejandro Sanchez. So 52 days, a month and a half, give or take, after the end of Absolute Power, the Justice League has rebuilt the satellite. So we are in Satellite Arrow 2. Mm-hmm. Everybody's getting Justice League cards. Darkseid comes back. We are taken to a universe where only Darkseid is. And our hero in central focus, Booster Gold. God help us all. I'm not complaining.
I like it. Booster Gold gets to shine. I love it.
Oh, no, I love it.
The fact that Booster Gold
I love it because Booster is actually a very competent superhero at times, and when it comes to stuff and time manipulation, he is only beat out by his own child, Rip Hunter.
Yeah.
At least in this continuity, I think that's still a thing. But now, what were you saying?
No, I was just saying that Booster Gold gets to shine. That's like, this is what I mean by DC actually going different directions. Like, you didn't have the quintessential trinity, like, oh, it takes Batman or Superman or Wonder Woman. You went so, this went so left field that it works. Considering the fact that this is dealing with the multiverse, this is dealing with Darkseid, and the fact that the only hope that we have currently is Booster Gold. And like you said, he's a guy that really is a competent superhero, really almost sometimes seen, I'm not going to say joke-ish or just always short of his potential, but in this run, this is his time to shine. And I really like the fact they're trying to go with that.
Also, it had a really solid Darkseid backup story.
Yeah. Yeah, Darkseid had Darkseid getting Thanos for a second. That's the thing. I felt really bad
for Michael Dorn because of Kalibak.
Damn. Again, that just damn. Go ahead, Joe.
No, like I said, it was a really solid backup that kind of informs you of Darkseid's role in all this. We are moving forward to where Booster Gold is probably going to be meeting the Darkseid variations of Batman, Superman, and Wonder Woman, which is where we get Brick House Batman, Tattooed Teenage Biker Wonder Woman, and mildly slimmer and needs a shave Superman.
The Superman who lied. I'm sorry, that's still sticking with me.
Yes, but the lie was that he would tell a lie.
That's such an opening for a story on a darker Superman, but chose not to do it. But I digress.
Yep. So this is everything we got from. Moving on over into Marvel, we got Curse of Kane, Chasm number one, written by Steve Fox with Andrea Bucardio in the second issue. This is significantly better than the first issue because we do address some things because Ben's starting to have blackouts. Droog is controlling him, so Hallow's Eve goes into Ben's mind. Ben still sees himself as a superhero deep within his mind. And they even state, like, they have both come to the conclusions, like, Ben does not have to be like Peter. So they are okay with those gaps in the memory so long as Ben is willing to form new ones and not dwell on it, which I think is a good thing. And Eve even sees Ben as the Scarlet Spider as his sensational form before Druid takes over and just kicks her out. Pretty much. Kane is still dealing with the unholy abominations of everything else, but this is a big step forward in this issue. Like, this was much better than the first one. But this issue was better than the first. Because it addresses a lot of issues we were having with a lot of stuff. Now, what is Druid of the Inhumans want to do with anything? I have no idea. And I have no idea what in God's name Mole Man is going to go get to fight Druid with, but good on him.
Yep, it is definitely going to be interesting what he does. Who or what weapon he finds? That's the question. Either a person or a weapon, but my money's on a person.
Well, I think it's like giant underground spider demons or something because of all the eyes.
Possible.
But no, I dug it. I do think this is a much more solid issue than the first one. First one was good, just kind of weird and laughable, but this one actually had some meat to it, so good on him. Mm-hmm. Next up, we got Uncanny X-Men number 3. This is written by Gail Simone with art by David Marquez, colors by Matt Wilson. We're just adding Nightcrawler to the Rogue team, which is pretty much at this point becoming the Rogue family, plus the New Mutants. We get to see, get all the backstory to all the new kids and what their powers are, except for the Horse Girl, who may be the daughter of a Valkyrie and may be half Asgardian and not a mutant at all, but time will tell. And Wolverine going over to his book finally and going, yeah.
The girl with the horse thing is just, yeah. Yep, not touching with a 10-foot pole, but go ahead.
Nope, solid issue. Let's you know who all the new kids are. Jitter is kind of like Prodigy, but like only for a literal minute. She can do anything she learned and then just execute it. Ransom apparently is functionally a new Darwin because he just can't be killed by anything. And anytime he dies, he gets a little bit stronger. And then the new Asian kid is basically Schrodinger in a perpetual state of being dead and alive at the same time and has horrifying powers.
Oh, the goth kid.
Yeah, the Japanese kid.
Mm-hmm.
So, like I said, I liked it. It was fun. It's nice seeing the kids interacting with Kurt. Rogue doing her best. She really is bringing like a very personal team of her own X-Men together. I hate the Wolverine's leaving to be in his own book, but he just doesn't want to be in the X-Men at this point, which is fair because everything have happened to him in Krakoa. But no, I continue to dig this book.
Nice.
Ultimate Spider-Man number 9. We get to see this red Jonathan Hickman, art by Mark Jetto, colors by Matthew Wilson. Kingpin just kind of assembles the Sinister Six, and we get to see what the code of conduct for superheroes are in this one. Harry, it's like, no, if they come after us, we put them in the ground. And Pete's like, do we though?
It was an interesting issue for this one. But you can kind of tell they are sowing the seeds for Harry to turn.
Is this the guy who can't draw feet?
Yes.
Okay.
No.
It's not.
That's Rob Liefeld.
Oh, he's not the artist for this one. I'm sorry. That's on me.
No, Rob Liefeld can't draw feet.
Yeah. I thought he was the artist for Ultimate Spider-Man. That's on me. That's wrong.
Okay, the name said I heard Liefeld, so
what can I say? Ultimate Spider-Man, again, like any other Spider-Man book we look at, continues to be better than the main Spider-Man book.
Mm-hmm. Nice.
One, which is a fantastic read. Never needs to go buy it and sub to it right now. This
actually buy two and get one for
Mirwa Adioli. Sorry if I'm getting it wrong. Art by Lucas Warnick. Cars by Alex Gutierrez and Fer Sanfuentes Sujo.
Mm-hmm.
Artwork is fantastic. We get to see her many, many uniforms and hairstyles in this one. She gets to team up with Frenzy.
Nice. Uh-oh. Did we lose Joe?
I think he's good.
Okay. And he kind of disappeared. It's got the circle of death on my side.
He's still here for me.
There we go.
Good.
Okay, you're good now.
Internet's just being weird. I don't know what's going on. But no, like I said, please go out, get the Storm book, support this book. It is fantastic. Art is fantastic. Story is fantastic. It just is going to help support more stories that we need in comic books. Plus, this is also just a nice little takeaway. This is a main book, I'm not going to lie, but this also supports the Avengers book as a secondary read moving forward, because we'll get to see Storm's primary life and Avengers life.
Nice.
Your thoughts?
Oh, I'm not spoiling anything. I will highly recommend to read it. Artwork is beautiful, and I love what they did with the first part of the story. I'm leaving it at that, because it's just one of those things. Although I will say, for a more in-depth look at this, if you do want full spoilers, please check out Room Full of Blurs, because Lainey, between Kira and Lainey and Reverend Navy, they went over this from one end of the cover to the other. So if you do want to be fully spoiled, definitely check out Room Full of Blurs. Their most recent episode was about this. But for me, I'm just going to tell people, read it. This is one of the very few times where we'll sit there and say, go out, support it. The more readers are picking up these issues, the longer this series will continue. So definitely do that.
Next up, we got Predator versus Black Panther issue 2. Lots of fighting. Lots of dying. Except not the main predator, the other predators that are hunting the Dor Milaje. Not everybody makes it out on both sides, and someone fights Black Panther, but the dude on the cover is still kind of just waiting and hunting.
He's kind of just hanging back and sending his henchmen like a really late Chinese martial arts movie. Like, he's the villain that sends the A team and then sends the B team and eventually will fight. That's kind of what I'm getting from this.
Same. Mm-hmm. Let me see. This is written by Benjamin Percy with art by Sean Damian Hill, with Jonas Trinidad and Lee Ferguson, colors by Eric Arcanila. Good book. Continue to support it. It's an interesting premise. Predator versus Black Panther. Solid read.
Mm-hmm.
Then we got X-Force number 3. This is written by Jeffrey Thorne. Art by Marcus Toe. Colors by Eric Arcaniga. This is a pretty interesting one, because we are dealing with Nucleo, who they actually give you a full rundown and back issues to go support. Hey, go read this book if you want the rundown on this guy. Big focus on Betsy, Rachel, and Surge, which I love. Mm-hmm. Something's going on with Rachel's powers all of a sudden. Betsy and Rachel are just having a minor relationship spat at this, but big focus Sun Surge. We're still trying to see who Tank is. At this point, I really think I could be wrong. It could be somebody else. It could also be a reborn Rock Slide.
Mm-hmm.
And just has a new costume this time around. I don't know who, what the big mystery is. Yeah, this could be Santos. I don't know. But I do dig it. It's one of the better X books. Oh, I forgot to get Avengers Ultraman. Go read Avengers Ultraman. It's a fun book to go read. I just forgot to put that in there, but it is in our list. Fun read. You get to see Tony playing with giant robot technology that's not normal to him, so he's having fun. And you get to see a very interesting mm-hmm. talk between Ultraman and Galactus. So go Sweet. Read that. It's just
fun. All right. Well, thank you for that pull list, Joe. And thank you all, as that pretty much will wrap up our podcast for this evening. We do thank everybody that liked, that commented. Again, please check out not only ourselves, which we'll get to momentarily, but again, want to shout out Geek by Heart and Room Full of Blurs. They can be found on all the socials. Definitely give them a like, share, and a follow. But I will start first with the man, the myth, the legend, who knows all the famous people. Him. Hey, Tamara.
Yeah, so you can find me under here on all platforms. AG. I do a lot of short form content, which apparently that's about to change on YouTube. You get 3 minutes now, so if your catalog shifts in the next couple of days, don't be shocked. But you can find me here. I also do editing on the Blurred Eye View channel, so you can catch me technically Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays. So I'm all places everywhere underneath this mantle.
Sweet. Joe, want to let people know what you're doing, sir?
I'm fighting with Terry on Twitch. Just made it to Gold Rank 2 after a very long hour and a half fighting session. Tonight, we're at Gold Rank 2 with Terry. We're going to see how far I can go. Over on Total Justice Gaming, I'm still playing Warhammer. I am playing Bolt Gun. Having a nice time with a small little community. It's just been a week and I haven't been able to play. Hopefully, they haven't all abandoned me already. Then Wednesdays we'll be picking back up Ultraman with Tafara and me. I just couldn't this week. I got a lot going on. I'm trying to help out the voting effort across Nashville with my local Asian Pacific Islander group. So I'm out there making sure people go cast a vote.
Mm-hmm. Vote.org. If
you don't know how to vote, please go to vote.org. They will teach you how to vote or cast a vote or register to vote or mm-hmm. where to vote. If you haven't picked up the hint, go vote.
Yep.
I don't care who it's for, just please do your duty.
I love the fact that so many people went to vote.org that it killed the timer. The countdown, the election day timer hasn't worked for like the last week or so. That's how much they've killed. That's how much people have visited it. But again, as Joe said, please register to vote. Not to get political here, guys, but same time, we don't need a second act of the Red Skull. I'm just going to leave it at that. If you don't get the reference, figure out which two candidates I'm talking about. It'll hit you. But before I do get to myself, guys, I do want to, again, always point out blurstation.com because, again, that is the vehicle, that is the table that we ask for content for us, owned by us, to put dollars back into our pockets. Why? I am tired of seeing Tubi win. Tubi is a $100 million network that is owned by the same guy that owns Fox. It is our viewership that creates these networks, that makes these networks bigger than what they are. So why not can we do for ourselves? Blurred Station can definitely do that. Definitely go to blurredstation.com, hit the join now button, select the Blurred Eye View Affinity membership. Any member down there, including myself, Black Spartan, Tafara TV, or Room Full of Blurreds, or Geek by Heart, select either one of us. We all, again, we accept, we would appreciate it. but it's $10.99 a month for viewing on for streaming on Blur Station. $10.99 a month. In 36 months, you have the opportunity to own a piece of Blur Station. And again, if you have content that you do want to show on Blur Station, you have to join as a member first, and then that allows you to talk to people behind the curtain. If all goes well, then your content that you own will continue to own will be shown on Blur Station. You can't beat that with a stick. At the same time, guys, please check out alwayspressrecord.com, APR TV. It's where you can see shows like ours and many others. And also APR is an app. APR TV is also an app that you get on your smart devices and Roku. So you can see all of us on television in the comfort of your own home. Watch us all. We appreciate it. But definitely check out APR TV because, again, it is a network for us, by us, that puts the money back to where it belongs with us. Now, as for me, guys, you can find me, Black_Spartan615 on the socials. I usually do reviews on everything. As Tafara TV said, please check us out on Blurred's Eye View every Tuesday and Thursday. Again, it is the Blurred Spot place to be, again, with our cohorts, as you did see in the comment section there with us as well. At the same time, guys, our podcast can be found where podcasts can be seen or heard. Spotify, Google Play, Apple, I want to say... They're the actual place where you can get podcasts dwindling, but you can find us, no problem. At the same time, guys, I'm going to keep on pointing out Tafara TV because Tafara TV has 3 videos about cons because con season is still going on strong. He has how to prepare for a con, what to do at a con, and what to do post-con. I highly recommend if you've never been to a con to actually watch these videos. They are very, 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 very informative as they have a few rules of my own also established in these. Number one, respect the cosplayer at all times. Cosplay is not consent. Please treat people like human beings. I cannot stress this enough. And I say this, and I say it's more to guys than I say to women, although it's to everybody. But guys, I understand, okay? But again, please treat the cosplayers like human beings. They are not pieces of meat. They are not there for your amusement. They are not there for your fondling, your groping. They are simply practicing what they love to do, and they want to show it off to the world. They are not there for your amusement, but you can appreciate them and treat them like freaking human beings. It's not that hard. Also, cosplay, again, cosplaying is for everybody, regardless of your height, weight, preference, or whatnot. The only rule that we have is don't do blackface. Don't want your ass kicked? Don't do blackface. That's simple. Number two is hygiene. I cannot stress enough about hygiene when you go to these cons. Please, clean clothes. Please make sure that you're clean. You washed your ass with soap and water and hopefully a bathing rag, a bathing wash towel. I hope because, you know, it's weird if you're just using soap because that's just nasty. But again, hygiene is important. Clean clothes is important because these cons are very closed off. You may not have a lot of room. At the same time, you don't want your funk entering a room before you do because you will clear that room out. Also, native deodorant doesn't work. And the other rule that I have, guys, again, for myself that I have for others, again, when you're at these cons, actually the same as in life. In a world that is cruel, unkind, cold, be nice, be kind. You can talk and share your fandoms, but don't be a dick and we'll all be cool. But as we wrap this up, guys, we are basically going to be hopefully back here next Friday, same Get Bit time, same Get Bit channel, with news of the week that you can use. We will come back next week with Bad Blood because that is happening tomorrow for WWE. We didn't get predictions in. That's fine. But we'll talk about what we thought about the PLE next Friday. But beyond that, guys, again, also, if you are in the path of Hurricane Helene, hopefully you guys are doing okay. Hopefully you're staying dry. We understand some people are still missing. Power is still out. Some areas are still cut off. Please reach out to who you can. There's plenty of areas like Goodwill and other FEMA acknowledged groups that are reaching out to these people. If you have the ability to donate your time or money or clothing, please do so. Because, again, not all of us are lucky enough to not be in the path of this hurricane. But again, if you can help, can. If not, then spread the awareness. That's how you can help as well. So again, for all those that are, you know, still recovering from Hurricane Helene, please stay safe. Please stay dry. At the same time, guys, if you can help, help. But before we call it a night, guys, any words, any final words we call it a night?
Donate money to anyone but the Red Cross.
Yeah, I was going to say, that's what I was forgetting. Yeah, the Red Cross is kind of corporate now. Joe?
I'm gonna go see what this Power Rangers movie on Tubi is. Keep Power hearing Rangers about
movie? Power so Rangers like movie on Tubi.
Made where the rest.
You're gonna tell me. I'm trying to avoid Tubi like the plague. But
yeah, there's a homemade Ghetto Rangers movie on Tubi. It's all over the place. To me, that's why Hellspawn sent that video to the group chat that just said irrational hatred.
I can only imagine, because if he's trolling it, then oh dear God.
Don't avoid Tubi. It actually has decent stuff. It's just, you know, the person's horrible. But I mean, it's the only place we can go watch like.
I will cruise the Grand Line.
I hate Tubi too, but it still has all the Ultraman and Super Sentai I can watch.
I understand.
I need Garfield and Friends, so I can sleep.
Don't get me wrong. I understand it's a preference, but I will sail the Grand Line first before I give Tubi any of my time or energy. But that's for a whole other discussion. But anyway, if you guys, like I said, stay safe, stay friendly, share your fandoms. Don't be dicks. At the same time, be nice to people. It's not that effing hard. I've been Will, he's been Joe, he's been Tafari. This has been the Gibbit Podcast for tonight, guys. Take care of yourselves and each other, and we'll get through this. Peace.
Later.
If this stream will end, will it end? Let's see. The stream is still going.
It's because we didn't pay for the premium plan.
Oh, did they not get us?
You know, next week's going to be really, really hard.